It was 2012, and I sat down at this table in Waterstones in Nottingham, and there was these two guys who just wouldn't look at each other, and there was this strange tension. I couldn't quite figure it out, and at first I thought he didn't want to be there. But the longer we sat there, I realised they just didn't want to be there together. The oldest of the two turned to me and handed me a stapled pile of papers, and he introduced himself as a writer. He wanted me to direct this film he'd written. I asked him why they wanted me to do it, and they told me they'd experienced filmmaking before and never wanted to do that again. And then they left, almost as quickly as they arrived. Before they left, I was able to get their names, Shaun Hardy and Matthew Elliott.
All I remember is hanging around with, I mean, it's such a long while. It was just, basically it was school stuff, it was just lessons and there was all that. Now and again we'd all meet up, but there wasn't anything, there wasn't a structured group, if you'd like. You know, there were no, it was just, you know, guys hanging around with guys. It was, you know what I mean, it was just that type of thing. Back then, we didn't do anything spectacular, we were just hanging around, going out, you know, sometimes playing football on lawn, and, you know, we'd all, you know, go camping and things like that, but there wasn't anything, you know, filming or, you know, things like that. That's, I mean, it was a long while ago, I can't really remember much of it now. I just remember us always messing about.
Film, like getting together as a group and just basically hanging around. There's just basically a group of friends getting along, going places, having fun, basically all that lot, yeah. But if I look back at it, and I look deeper into it, watching some of the old stuff, it does get to me, because that's when everyone was together. And that's when everyone was close in a sense, but with a bit immature.
before any of this, there was ex-placebo. I grew up in a small town of Kirkby and Ashfield with a really was not anything to do. If you were a kid in Kirkby, there was nothing you can do. There was parks, and there was the streets that you could probably play on, you know, every now and again if you were lucky, unless you wandered into a bad area. But there was nothing to do. And it was around early 2004. No. It was around late 2004, early 2005, when me and my mum moved into this house on Welbeck Street, just up from Diamond Avenue. Well, just around the corner. And I was given this video camera as a gift. And I'd grown up with my grandparents, and my granddad was always recording things, and I think that's where I got my motivation from. And eventually I met this guy, Steve, who lived next door. And I can't remember how we met, but I think at one point he must have caught me recording things on my back garden, because around this time, when I'd gotten this camera, I was just recording anything. There's so many random clips that ended up on this VHS tape, and I didn't know what it was. I did not know what it was. By the end of it, Stephen got involved, and he created quite a bit of content with me. And then along came Michael Barnes, who really completed it, really carried it on his shoulders. But at the end, I was just left with this little VHS tape full of random crap, random clips. And I never would have thought back then that little VHS tape would have started a 10-year experience, a decade-long experience. Now I can say, and I will say this, I will take the credit for this. I know, had it not been for ex-placebo, there would have been no A.C.T. And I can say that. And I will take the credit for that. Thank you.
Welcome to the Swedish prostitute. It's more like this.
It's more like that.
Okay. One sentence. Okay, now it's my turn. What's not the strength?
Hey, I can see you.
Bye, everybody.
So, before school and before I met everyone in A.C.T, it was just pretty much me and Cav. And in pre-sick, my primary school and his primary school as well. We pretty much knocked about with each other. We did lots of silly things. And it was just, for a lot of time, it was me and Cav. And I don't know, I can't remember a lot of it. Cav did his own thing for the most part, but we sometimes linked up when we were in separate classes. And we came out for a lunch break, and we just pretty much caused a lot of trouble. I don't think he caused as much trouble as I did, but I'm sure he would disagree.
Funnily enough, me and Cav, we was in, you know, it was in my lesson, I think it was my science lesson actually. He'd been in my lesson for like, I don't know, three years, maybe 3 years. I can't remember the exact date, well, exact time frame, but basically we came about because there was some sort of argument in lesson, and we all stuck up for him at one point or another, and he stuck up for me. I can't remember now what about it, about some woman, I think, somebody we were arguing with, calling her names. So we started talking, and but he'd been in lesson like for 3 years at this point, and no one really spoke to him, and you know what I mean, he was an outsider. So it was like, oh hello, I'm Cav, I'm Shaun, and we started talking, and then before we know it, things got more thingy, you know, more, and I'll say, you know, all friendship went a bit further, and then obviously eventuality is he became involved in the circle, and he was involved with all the, well, with the filming as well, and I've had him ever since then.
After Mike, see, I was quite a loner at school. I didn't have many friends at all, and Mike, you know, even though my, you know, we were best friends, he still had his own group of friends as well, you know what I mean? So there would be times where we wouldn't be together, and it was around this time that I met Liam. And Liam Kavanagh was the first person of A.C.T. After Mike to actually involve me in his group of friends. Now his group of friends included a guy named Adam Norton, who I hated. I absolutely hated him.
Funnily enough, I met Adam because he was a bully, funnily enough, in Chesterfield. So, you know, he doesn't know that bit, that I know that, but he was a bully. He used to go in Chesterfield house, things, sit on with Karen and whatever, and he used to throw slang at people and all this. And I don't know how we got speaking in that way, but later on, Big Ash introduced him and he in our lesson, and then we just started talking, but I didn't know at the time he was getting best mates with Cav, so naturally we all got on quite well since then. But Adam would just appear, he wasn't just there, he just appeared. That was the thing with him.
It was just sort of a different experience. I was a lot more crazy and wild. I was carefree. It was hard for me to sort of concentrate on something, think about something, and consider someone's feelings. I was kind of a bully. I was a bit of an idiot. But as soon as I hit secondary school and started getting to know everybody from A.C.T, I settled down quite a lot. So the bully became the bully. So yeah, my life before A.C.T was something of a mystery in a sense.
I was at Ashfield Secondary School, and I met a guy called Michael Barnes, and it turned out that he lived just up the road from my grandma, maybe a 5 minute walk, and I just started getting, there was something about him, you know, there was something about him, he was genuine. I'd never met anyone like him, and I've never met anyone like him since. He was just an absolute one of a kind man, you know. And we were inseparable. We were inseparable. We could spend weeks constantly in each other's company. A lot like Adam and Liam would, actually, a few years later. But this was before I'd met them. And me and Mike were best friends, man, you know what I mean? Just absolute best friends. He still is now, and I haven't spoken to him in years. Properly, anyway.
From what I remember, I think he was in our lesson as well, one way or another. I don't think he was straight away. There was a couple of lessons that he weren't in, and I think one way or another, he sort of like he appeared again, but he was more reserved and a bit more laughing, joking about. I think that's how we all got on with him, especially, you know, Adam and Kav. They got on with him like ass and fire, because it was like, you'd ever laugh with him, and, you know, silly things like he'd chuck some at a thing and everyone would laugh, and, you know what I mean, he'd do that. But then, I used to go to Mike sometimes, so, you know, I used to talk to Mike there, and as I say, it just happened. It wasn't, it was like chemistry. You just know when to talk to someone and when not to talk to them, you know. I mean, there was tons of other people in lesson, but there was only like a couple on as we all used to speak, you know. Or everyone else was, back in them days, not very nice people. But, you know, Mike sort of like followed us, and then he became in the group at the time. But as I say, it's long time ago now. Well, when I was hanging around with Mike, naturally, you know, he had some of his you know, his own friends that obviously wasn't in our lessons. So, you know, naturally, you'd bump into him in quad, and obviously, one of them was God, I really bad cough. Was Matt.
So I just got hanging around with these people, with these guys, and it was a lot different to kind of what I'd been doing originally. The kind of people that I'd be hanging around originally. These guys were, they had their own clique. It was very difficult as an outsider to kind of get in with them, because they had their own little, they had their own little group, and it wasn't easy. Liam would actually turn around, still to this day actually, he turns around and says that without him, I probably wouldn't have been able to be friends with them. And yeah, I think he's true. I think he's got a point. It's very, very difficult to get into that group. It was for me, anyway.
And, you know, we all got talking. I don't think Coop was impressed with him at the start. He wasn't, I don't know, Coop had this thing like, oh, I don't like him, he's an outsider, I'm not having him in our group.
As people probably know, me and Matt didn't really sort of get along in school, so.
I look back and I remember hating Adam, and I remember that he hated me. He plays it down sometimes. He plays it down. He says he doesn't, but he did. He did. We despise one another.
But, story short, I mean, we all got talking again. Mike introduced, and then we all got talking. We used to meet up, especially, I tell you, we used to all meet up at dinner around Trent, especially around Trent. I can remember that quite well. And then we had like a nice big circle of a group, and then eventually, what happened where is we had this filming idea. We always used to mess about, you know, oh, let's take a video, something silly, and dropping down some stairs or whatever. Eventually it came to the point where, oh, let's go down Kirby, we'll film some Jackass type stuff, we'll go down there, we'll do these silly things, and we'll be famous, and we'll have loads of money. So, oh, sounds great, jumping off buildings or whatever, jumping in bushes. So, you know, I went down, and there was just Matt, I think Upton was there, and we came to a point where there was the railway pub, and I remember coming around, I think Cav was with him as well, I can't remember it all very much now. And I remember him chucking this brick off this roof, and obviously it missed me, but I remember that. And then a bit further on, we went down the quarries, and they pushed me down the quarries in like a trolley thing, almost cracked my head on the side, like. But that was the start of it all, as far as I remember. From there we decided, oh, I wanted to film some more, we needed to get some more filming done and things like that. And then obviously one thing led to another.
So I started hanging around with Liam, Shaun, not so much Adam, By this point, I think Adam had different friends anyway. Adam had another group of people. But even if we were together, we didn't speak. And I started hanging out with these guys. And during this, me and Mike had just finished Ex Placebo. And being the guy that I was, I imagine that I would have made a point of telling people, gloating, that we just made this film. I didn't mention to them that the film was rubbish, you know, but I would have mentioned that we'd made this film. And I'm not sure where it started, but all I know is that for one reason or another, minus Adam, we all ended up discussing this film, Ex Placebo 2. And Ex Placebo 2 was basically going to be like, just like the first one, but it was stunts. It was going to be stunts. It was a Jackass ripoff, basically. Which we weren't the only ones doing. There were a lot of people doing these things. I'd done one a few years earlier with a different group of friends, the title of which I can't say on this. We had been doing that for a while. We had a reputation for being those kind of people. And eventually, that would actually start all of this off, and it would be a landmark in the group. It was November 18th. 2005, and we were in Kirkby.
But I think Cav was with me. He stopped, or we was going to make his way down.
Well, I went down and got Michael Barnes, and I can't fully remember how it all worked, but I just know that in Kirkby and Ashfield on that day, there was me, Shaun, Liam, Michael, Heather Morgan, who was a friend at school. So we filmed what eventually became Ex Placebo 2. And Ex Placebo 2 was kind of something that everybody over the next few years that knew was watched. They watched it. I don't know many people that didn't watch that film, one way or another. Out of our group and out of, you know, close friends, stuff like that. It was always shifted about somewhere. Probably not for the right reasons, but it just was. So we filmed that on the Saturday, and on the Sunday, November 19th, 2005, we filmed the second day, but this time including James Housley and Sarah Ann Palmer. And that was strange. That was a strange day, because we had somewhat of an after party, which was ridiculous. It was absolutely ridiculous. But funnily enough, the nice thing was is that the film ended in the room that the first one started, which kind of gave it a really nice symmetry, because even though there would be a few more Ex Placebo films that we would make, none of them really would have the same effect as Ex Placebo 2. Another interesting thing about that, the 19th of November, that night after the after party, there were four people left in this house. And it was me, Shaun, Liam, and Michael. And that was the night that we formed a group called A.C.T, which would eventually, you know, well, I suppose what this film's all about.
I mean, it was a fun time, you know, different, unique, in the sense that we're all idiots back then, which we were, you know. But that's what you do when you're kids, you just, you know, film silly stuff and look at it back and go, what an idiot, you know. But you know, it brought us all together. We all did his own thing, and you know, some on us are still knocking about and some on us aren't now. You know, we do our own thing, but it's just one of them things, we ex-placebo, and then obviously that went further on to other things we did.
Two. I didn't do one, I think that was between Matt and Mike, I can't remember. But we did ex-placebo too, and I can remember doing crazy things like that and wearing Matt's arse and upstairs and I had guitar. I've only just recently seen footage of that not long back. And I didn't even know it was there, and like, I can't remember that, but now I can. And that was a good memory for me, because there were Mike, there were quite a load of people doing some filming. I didn't do a lot of filming, because some things, projects I didn't get invited to, but it, like I say, that's what I can remember. I regret not coming out as much, and not getting involved in groups as much. And let's not forget, ACT, right, actually started from the Generosity Gang. So, I'll just put that in there.
Yeah, I do remember having some pictures taken. Funnily enough, I can still remember them clear as day, actually. We had some pictures in the living room in between, I think it was the stairs or the doorway. And that was, we said that day, right, we're going to start doing films now, there's going to be no messing about, we're going to make some serious stuff. We're going to get down to basics, because we had tons of pictures, I think, but the thing is, back then, it was just us four. I mean, Adam was in it, but he wasn't in the ex-placebo stuff, he was more into more serious stuff, and that's when he came into it more, naturally, but from that day, we woke up, it was like a new beginning, if you like. I mean, it's not, I mean, what I remember is, it like, yeah, let's do this, we had like a hobby, something different, it wasn't just going to school, coming back, watching a film and then going up and we rinse and repeat. We were doing something different that no one else were doing. Yeah, it was silly, but we got the memory and the time where we're all together, and it's an experience in that sense.
There's a level of big-headedness that comes from that, and that doesn't really go away. Because you can be sat in a room with anybody and all you are thinking, no matter what the conversation is, no matter who the person is, you can be sat there and you can be thinking, I've just made a film. What did you do with your weekend? And you know it doesn't matter what that person did at their weekend, because no matter what they say, you're still going to go, yeah, well, I made a film. There's a huge level of dickishness that comes from that, and it's not right, but we were 15, and, it's the best time for it, really, isn't it? I remember there being lots of paperwork, lots and lots that came with ACT. And it wasn't good paperwork. It was terms and conditions and rules. That's what came from that. That's what came. There was very strict rules in ACT, and mostly written by Shaun.
Well, I remember writing the contract. I mean, it was very strict. I remember we had this really set, like, to the point where if you can't do this, you're not in it type thing. You know, we're not we as you're against us. So there was, I remember some of them. I remember your friends, I think I'm right in thinking this. Your friends are always in front of your girlfriends, so but you've got to prioritise. Filming and all that comes first. If you haven't got time, you've got to let us all know. I know everybody's busy. I remember things like that. I remember you've got to give a lot of notice, because then we're going to need someone else to fill your role. I mean, it's a long, long time ago. I mean, I know we had to sign it. I know everyone had to sign the contract at the bottom. I do remember that. There was some absolutely stupid rules. You know, it were like, I mean, it's such a long time. I remember writing them, especially that chairman's diaries. I just cannot remember anything. It's like so long ago. I remember nobody cared about the rules. That's one thing I do remember. Now you broke a rule. that's it now, we've got to discipline you. But nobody cared anyway, so, but, you know, it was like this contract, you know, it was good. At the time, it made sense, tried to keep a structure together, but fundamentally, it didn't work.
I don't know about loyalty, but there was passion. Because you can't really say loyalty, because everyone betrayed each other.
By this point, Shaun had become essentially the leader of ACT, because around that time, for one reason or another, if anybody had a problem, if Liam or Adam or any of that original group had a problem, they all went to Shaun. Shaun was essentially an agony aunt to his friends, and I'm not sure why, but that's the way it was. So he was the best person in our minds to be the so-called chairman of ACT, and I hate that word, really, chairman, and I think it's because of that, because I think that the minute that we started to appoint ranks in the group, that's really when it all went to shit, I think, that point. And we all did it, we were all terrible for it, and I know there was one occasion where somebody from a rival, where somebody, a particular someone, I'm not going to say the name because I'm not sure they want me to, but there was one person who wanted to come to this event, and I can't remember why it was, and I actually wrote them a formal letter telling them they couldn't. I mean, talk about dickishness, you know? But oh, it was fantastic. Those days were fantastic then, because you really were. You saw yourself as better than anyone else, and it was terrible. It was absolutely terrible. That person who didn't eventually come to that event, I don't think. There'd be occasions where they'd remind me of that, and that would remind me of all of the shit that these contracts brought you to. If there was something that somebody else didn't like, you'd shot it. It was just after ACT, and I knew that I was left with this footage of X-Placebo 2, and this was before YouTube as I knew it, and long before I'd even entertained the idea of that, and I put X-Placebo 2 onto a VHS tape, and I knew that what I had to do was get the footage off that VHS tape and onto multiple VHS tapes so that everybody who was involved in the film could have a copy. I think that's how I spent January 2006, actually. Aside from being at school, I was sat in a bedroom in Kirkby in Ashfield, constantly transferring X-Zero 2 VHS, and I think I must have watched that film about 7 times, and I think that probably the last time I watched that film, I'd say that within a month I already hated that film for that. February was a little different.
It was something that was, obviously, because me and Matt was friends anyway. I went to Matt's house, and obviously my dad was single anyway, so I'd go down and I'd get picked up sometimes, and there was something about to go off, and then naturally things went to another, and then eventually Matt came to live here. at mine, and then we started doing obviously more filming and more, everyone was, you know, meeting up a bit more. But I mean, I just remember Mum's coming up and Matt stopped, and I think Mum picked Matt up or something, and then one thing led to another, and then before you know it, I says to Matt, I says, I bet you they get together. Oh really? Yeah, they're going to get together. And then dreamt that, and it happened, so just fate into it really.
The interesting thing that A.C.T brought was that it was just at the right time, because we were so busy working on the whole notion of this group and the plans that we were going to do that year and how we were going to become famous and all the rest of the shit that came with it. There wasn't really any time to really deal with this complete change in lifestyle, in life, because we were just too busy doing that. I think at one point they must have sat us down and explained the whole situation, and I genuinely can imagine that we were sat there probably still with a paper and pen and just going, yeah, whatever, we've got to write something. When you have two people who are part of a film group together all the time, all possibilities are open to you at that point. And I had made Explosivo by just recording random stuff, and so I started to do that again. But this time, you know, a different house, occasionally. I mean, we made something called, well, it was made because I'd wanted to record every time that me and Shaun were together, because we were always trying to come up with ideas, and I thought, what better way than to record us talking about, you know, anything, because if we come up with an idea, it's there, and we've got it. And that became something called ACTTV. And ACTTV is probably my favourite part of that whole experience. Because ACTTV was pretty much Explosivo rebranded. Explosivo 1 rebranded. And there's nothing that we ever did more personal, more revealing than that. Because that is us at any time of day. It's basically reality TV, which long before you had the whatever shit realities on TV now, it was us. We started reality TV, yes, I suppose. Well, maybe not started it, we made it better.
ACT, well, the first ACT TV, volume 1, was basically, it was just, as I say, you know, filming day-to-day things. There was no story or there was no real point to it in the sense, but it was like I say, it was an own video. I mean, I remember many times we'd put the camera on and we'd film just going to KFC, just having a drive to KFC, and me, I'm getting in the car, we'd just film things like that. There was a silly bit where I filmed a tea commercial. I think I was working for PG at the time, you know, showing how to make tea. A bit silly like, but you know, just one of them things. But then obviously, you know, we'd film silly things. The one thing led to another, like Matt used to record himself doing silly things in mirror, pulling faces and things like, well, as far as I remember anyway, it was one of them.
So eventually, I don't know, I can't remember why, but I do remember what happened. We were outside Trent, which is where we used to hang out at school, and our school had houses, you know, like Harry Potter, but boring. And there was one, Trent, and it's where all of the rockers and the grebs, I suppose, were. And we were into that, you know? We were into that. I mean, we didn't wear the fingerless gloves out, you know, or the strange eyeliner, but, you know, but they were into that, so, you know, that's fair enough, that's their game. But we weren't like that. We liked the music, but, you know, didn't need to show it, really. And so we started hanging around there, and there was one day where, like I said, I can't remember what happened, but I know that I don't know why it happened, but I got Adam in headlock, and we started fighting.
It got into a huge fight once. And that's one thing that I certainly can remember.
And somebody from Trent House, maybe a teacher or something, came out and broke it up. And then we became friends.
And from there on, the fight started dying down. Slowly and slowly, but they still remained. And we still didn't fall out.
Still to this day, neither of us can explain why. But yeah, suppose that was just one of those things, perhaps. There were lots of fallouts around this time. The thing with ACT was that we spent more time falling out with each other than we actually did working with one another, to be honest with you. And there was not a day that went by where someone didn't fall out with someone else for days, weeks at a time. I mean, it was normally Adam and Liam. Shaun would fall out with one of them.
There were always a lot of arguments, and I felt like sometimes I was like the outcast, like, you know, getting bullied out. That's how I feel sometimes. But it wasn't. There were different people as well, not just me. So I do have kind of a hatred towards it.
So it was normally one of those, and there was so many fallouts. There was so many fallouts that I imagine everybody was relieved when it all ended.
We had a lot of fallouts during the ACT days in school, and it was mostly involving me. So I felt a different counterpart to the group, and it wasn't until later films that I started becoming involved in the activity of ACT. The early days were, as I can remember, hard for me, if I'm honest. And a lot of the periods in school, for me, were hard to endure until I started becoming friendly with everybody. But that was few and far between.
I'd made ACT TV 1 in a weekend. Not recorded. We'd recorded it over a period of time, but it took me a weekend, two all-nighters, to edit that first one together. And it was the first time I'd worked with computer editing software, because we didn't use any editing software on any of the 2X Placebo films. I think that's probably obvious to anybody who watches it, but we didn't use it. So that was the first time that I'd worked with that and hadn't put some on a VHS tape. That's probably another reason why that stands out to me, was that that was the first. That paved the way. And as soon as that came out, I don't know if anybody will. I know that people watched it, but I don't know if it was an immediate thing. I don't know if people. So I don't even know if me and Shaun ever watched it. I certainly did not watch any ACT film during these years, because I'd sat up editing it. I was always editing them. So there was really no need for me to sit and watch them. I'm not that kind of person. You know what I mean? I don't make something and then sit and admire it. I kind of make it, it's edited, and then that's it. It's for everyone else. for everyone else. They wanted it. But this must have worked. This must have worked quite well, because it wasn't far afterwards that we made A.C.T. TV 2, which was the first one, I think, to go into the school.
A.C.T.
A.C.T. Volume 2. That's the start, really, mainly for me. Well, for the lot of us. It had more of a structure, obviously, too. It wasn't just filming, walking down the street type. Well, it was. It had some silly bits, but I remember the intro. I do remember that quite well. It was me, Cav, Kim, I think, and that might be James, I can't remember. We all shared A.C.T. That's the main intro of that first one. That's how it started, if I remember right. It's where we did meet James Isley, a big guy, like giant guy. Everyone used to shout at him and he said loud voice. He got involved for a while. I remember Dad drunk. That's one of the things I do really remember that one quite well, because I was dead angry that night and they were all trying to dance and show everyone up, like, you know, who can do lollipop and things like that, and we had everyone wiggling and I'm thinking I can't put up with this. That were funny. And then I'm trying to think now, memories serve me right. Back then we met Kim was involved, I think that was the one as well, Kim. We had a couple of silly pictures outside the house. Yeah, we did. I mean, it's a long time now. I remember quite a lot of it, but it's yeah.
Okay.
I remember Slippy Day. I do remember Slippy Day. There's something I do remember quite well. That's the only decent thing I ever filmed. Well, falling over. That's probably the best way to sum it all. But me slipping and breaking my neck, yeah, that was. I did enjoy that. I always wanted a second one though. But yeah, I enjoyed Volume 2. Volume 2 was quite an interesting time, I think. That's before the other people got involved, you know.
I think we filmed a lot of A.C.T. TV 2. We had additional people involved this time. We had a bunch of people. Kim Bowie. I'm going to cut that last bit. We had a lot of people joining, a lot of friends from school, and that, it was better than the first one. And during this time, I mean, as is obvious, I think, when you watch it, at this point we were between homes. We were in the process of moving from Kirkby to Sutton, and so you had a lot of that came in. We had a lot of, you know, school inspired things happening in this time. Genuinely can't remember, even after hours of thinking, where this came in, where this started in, where this made sense, but somewhere along the road there was Exclusivo UK, which essentially completed the A.C.T. group at this point, because you had Dave McCormack, Matthew McCormack, you had a lot of people. Exclusivo UK was the last film where we were all together, where everybody made it somewhere, one way or another, even if not in every scene together, was the last where we all stood together.
Yeah, I mean, Exclusivo UK, I remember when we first met, you know, Patch and Day, briefly, because I remember them wanting to do some really silly things, like jumping in bushes and jumping off skate parks and, you know, doing backflips and front flips and side flips, whatever. There was that. I remember I think that's when Ash was in it as well. I think Ash was in it. I can't remember much because I didn't take much part in it, to be honest, because I weren't in all that silly stuff. I couldn't see a point in jumping in buildings and things. I couldn't understand it, to me. But yeah, I do remember we all had a picture on a big tree. It was on the lawn. I think it's on, is it Mickey's Hill, is it? I think Mickey's Hill. Up there, I remember us all having a picture. I mean, I'm more in it for the filming, like, you know, back behind the scenes like then. But that was, I do remember quite a lot of that. But I didn't take much active part in it. I sort of set a step back on that one until I went back to ACT stuff.
So 2006, we leave school, and we knew things were going to be different. We knew we were coming back for sixth form, but we knew a lot of our friends weren't, and we are lucky because ACT TV 3 featured our leaving day, and our after party, and it was a very strange time.
I remember leaving day, well, leaving in general. I mean, to be honest, I didn't want to leave because we all had a group, and I thought as soon as we'd all left, it'll be, oh, Cav's gone, oh, Mark's gone, everyone's gone, then we've lost that group connection, and then we've all got to do his own thing, and, you know. Naturally, we stayed on a little bit longer than that, quite a lot, actually, some of us did. But I remember leaving day quite vaguely. I'm not sure if we got this in the right order, but we went to King and Miller, and this is when Hoggard was involved as well. Hoggard come with us. It was really silly, by the way. Hoggard was. It was just messed about. But they were funny. We're all at King and Miller, we'd all got our suits on and and things like that. That was a good night. I still got all the pictures for them, actually. Day was there, and that was the night, funnily enough, where Matt brought Mike a meal, but he brought his son a meal, but he didn't get Mike one. He took his money. I don't know how that happened, but I do remember that briefly. And then at some point we went to the cinema. I might have got it in the wrong way round, but we went to the cinema and we thought, bro, we'll go to the cinema on leaving day, there'll be a mint film on. Went down, it was frigging Da Vinci Code on. We put that on. Half on us a drop into friggin' sleep. I don't even know what happened in film. All I remember is, oh God, in that, went checking their ass on that advert and he was chucking stuff at the end of the screen. The only thing I remember about that night.
There was a huge fallout. Shortly after Happy Cam Live came into the scene. And the fallout wasn't between everyone in the group, it was something that was happening personally with Shaun, and the effect, the ripple of that. A lot of it becomes quite clear in ACT TV 4, which is very different from the rest of them in terms of mood, and we were 16, you know, we were 16 at this point, we'd finished school. Things were getting weird. We was just starting to learn to live together. You know, that didn't come easy. Because you have two different people in a household in one room, you know? There was conflict, a lot of conflict. But that's what happens, you know, it's brothers.
Well, ACT Volume 4. I think it was I can't remember much of that, I just think it was a blur. I just remember little snippets of information back then. I remember writing Louisa's name in sand, I remember going to King and Miller and recording all of us eating dinner. I don't know why we did that, but other than that, I can't remember anything. I've completely gone over my head. I think, yeah, that's right, yeah.
By this point, I think it was over. I think ACT was spiritually over as soon as we left school.
as soon as we left school, I think that was it.
Yeah, I remember said we were going to do one more project, and God, such a memory. By this point anyway, the majority of the group was just generally fed up of filming. I mean, you've got to think, you've done four films and a couple of other side projects, you're going to get fed up. Plus, we were getting on a bit, so naturally by then, Adam didn't want to film, Mike didn't want to film, especially Mike, Mike didn't want to film a lot. I was losing interest as well. I mean, we'd done all these A.C.T. things, and then they decided, oh, let's do another crazy film where we're jumping in bushes again. I thought, well, we've been through this. You know, we've done all these silly projects. You know, so they was on about trying to build this sort of passion day and things like that. But by this point, nobody wanted to do anything. We were just hanging around, oh, Lord, let's take some video, let's do some silly things. But by then, everything was going sour. A lot of people weren't interested. Kav was always hanging on. Kav was like, no, we've got to film, we have to film. It's our what we've got to be. He didn't want to change that. I mean, I didn't really. But not the same group was around, and that's ultimately what happened. Everybody sort of drifted off and did their own little thing for a while and come back. But, you know, they didn't want to come out much now. At this point, they was just, oh, can't be bothered, not bothered. So there was that, and, you know, everybody was like it, just weird out. I think the fuel ran out of the fire. That was the way that went.
Well, we started college. We did A.C.T. TV5. By this point, we weren't enjoying it. It was a chore. I remember A.C.T. TV5 being an absolute chore, and none of us wanted to do it. None of us wanted. Shaun was losing the spark for it. Shaun was starting to have enough of it. And sixth form rekindled something.
The sixth form days are where my memories are the strongest. It's where me, Matt, Leah, Ash, and Shaun, we all joined together. It seems like we bonded a hell of a lot more in sixth form, but we used to sort of bond a lot more outside of school rather than in school. But it was the same in school. We certainly did sort of spend a lot more time with each other because we were in classes together, and the lunch breaks were a lot more free-flowing. We felt like we could be in places where we bonded a lot more instead of sort of being outside the trend, and you've got groups of people in different areas of school that are watching you. Certainly the old chavs that kick footballs at you, it was a lot more hostile back then. But when we were in sixth form, we had a lot more places where we could go, and you'd feel a lot more comfortable. So it was a strength for us. We bonded a lot more because of that.
Yeah, sixth form, my dad, funny enough, I can't remember sixth form quite good actually. sixth form was quite a good time for me, especially me anyway. I remember us all congregating in the sixth form centre. I forgot the name of it now, big room type thing, massive room. Kav never used to come to sixth form very often. There was just me and Ash and Coop, really, well, Adam, really. We had quite a big group. I did actually like that, because I spent the most at sixth form, and I naturally spent the most time with everybody else there. So, but yeah, that was a good time. I do miss that. That's something I do miss. I miss all them, all that group. Because they're more mature, they're not silly, they're not jumping around and fighting and doing no point scoring. It was just nice, it's what you want. I remember, because obviously naturally it was all at sixth form, there was me, Ash, Matt and Coop, well, Adam, I keep saying Coop, but Adam, and Gemma used to come down, another person. I'm not sure if he'd film this, but Gemma would come back with us as well, and we'd all go back to Matt's, and we'd all have a Thursday afternoon, oh, I could do with a drink, get Budweiser out, a couple of cans, and just mess about, don't we, and then go back into lesson, pissed up, we're all a bit cocky, I'll always remember that.
Sixth form, in between three periods, seemed to bring everyone together, and we made new friends, new people. There was something different by that point. And I think that shows. But the mistake we made was having run out of ideas, was to resort back to the very beginning. And I think that's apparent in Daredevil Syndicate, which was never released. We released a trailer, never released the film. In true ACT spirit, that's true form from ACT, that was. To make something, do it half-assed, then not even bother with it.
Remember Daredevil Syndicate? We did that during 6 form days. And we had Ash as a part of the group, and I believe that he was a main figure of it at that time.
And more Fallouts. You never stop with them. You never stop with them. Around this time, I dropped out of college.
I mean, we all started sort of going our separate ways, and the whole group itself, ACT Certain, it broke up when we left school, and then we all started to look for work. Matt got a job first, I think, and then Shaun got one, and Ash obviously went off and did his separate thing.
Back then, we were still trying to keep together. Kath was hanging on, Adam was hanging on just about, but Ash was moving away slowly. Gemma still stayed though. I think she stayed for another year, I think, I'm not quite sure. But yeah, a lot of things changed obviously by this point, because people are doing their own thing, so naturally nobody wants to film, you know, when we're doing their own thing. And then I got a job, so you know, one thing led to another, and then we'd all split. But we were still knocking about. I mean, Ash completely gone at this point. He'd gone. You didn't see him. We've only just recently started speaking to him again.
And then that was it. No one ever held a flag up and said, that's it, we're done here. Nobody ever, we weren't like that. We weren't those kind of people. It had been, by this point, it had been 2 years. It had been 2 years of constant fallout. It had been 2 years of us making plans that never happened. It was 2 years of the same old shit, and 2 years of just lies, lying to each other, telling each other you enjoyed it, you didn't. No one enjoyed it. I can't think of anybody towards the end that would say, oh, I loved it, I enjoyed it. It was horrible.
I'd say ACT ended just after 6 form, or maybe just slightly before 6 form ended. Because I remember, obviously Ash was quite a big part of it as well in some of the other things. He'd gone, he'd completely just got a job and he'd gone. Adam had as well, but we were all talking still briefly. We got a bit sick of everybody talking, you know, because you got to think, if you've been around each other 7 years, taking films and video, and you know, you get fed up. We always used to argue every other week, someone would fall out, and, you know, we'd all got fed up with that. But, ACT finished in a sense when everybody didn't want to come out. You'd ask them and they'd say, no, I can't come out, I'm busy. No, I've got things I'm doing. Mike completely gone. He was first out at Rabbit, he'd gone. Because I think after 6 form at that rate, we didn't see out to him much. But it ended when everybody just stopped talking really for a while. We all went silent, did his own thing, and you know, that's how that ended really.
We couldn't talk to each other without arguing. That even me and Shaun couldn't talk to each other without arguing. We'd all had enough by this point. And so that was it. We all knew. No one needed to point that. We didn't need to have a meeting. You know what I mean? It was pretty much, this is shit, I'm out, I'm done. And that was it. We never looked back. And that was the end.
I wish we could have done things differently. People stayed together and did carry on filming, but actually made it work.
Liam joined the army. So he went and joined the army, but that didn't work out for him. So he went and got a flat. The army paid for a flat for him. So he had his own place. He moved out and he was living in Sutton. And obviously I was in college. So I was doing my separate thing as well. And during that time, when we all sort of moved off and looked for work, we had a blank period where we didn't contact each other. It was only sort of Matt and Shaun that kept close because they lived with each other.
I still lived with Shaun. There were no avoiding that. Still lived with Shaun, and regardless of all the fallouts, we were close, and we were close enough that we knew that were done, but we'd still all talk to each other, but now we didn't have to contend with the constant, there were no more rules. That was the main part. There was no rules at this point. It was over. That was it. It was done. And in 2009, it was, because I went off the grid for about 2 years. 2 years I made sure that I didn't see anyone. About 2009, I was 18. I was 18 by this point, and so obviously at this point I was out, I was drinking. I was drinking quite heavily.
Kav was around a little bit, but Kav was, by this point, Kav had got a flat, and, you know, he'd been in the army and then he'd been discharged. So by this point, we were just having parties. It was just parties, drinking parties. You know, we'd have these really good parties. And then eventually, some of us come back together. You know, quite a lot of us did actually. Adam and everyone come back together, and it was nice to get back in a routine again. Not the same, because not everybody was there.
I don't know whether it was Shaun that contacted me and sort of got us back together, whether it was Matt. I think it may have been Matt that did it. He had a more uplifting spirit than Shaun, and he sort of managed to group us all together. So throughout. After leaving school, it was sort of Matt that grouped us together, and we considered him the leader. So we all followed him, and I can't remember what year it was that we all started sort of getting together again, but whether it was when Shaun was knocking about with Louise and all those from Happy Camp.
I think that's what brought us all back together, actually. was going out. We'd spend a lot of time drinking, we'd spend a lot of time out. We'd go to the Ashfields pub. That was our hot spot. That's where we went, and we'd just spend our weekends doing that. And it was nice because we were able to see, it was the first time in 4 years that we were able to all sit around and talk and laugh and chat without arguing, without falling out. And that was important. That was what kept us together. It was as soon as we realised the mistake that we'd made was actually forcing each other to stay.
and each one of us I know in ACT didn't want to be there, but we stayed there for everyone else. So when you have a whole room of people that don't want to be there, but think that everybody else wants them there when they don't, it's a nightmare.
When we had little parties at Liam's flat, we used to drink like crazy then, and that's when we used to get really, really blind drunk. And that's when me and Matt started linking up really well. That's when we first started hitting it off, and we started going to these all different house parties, crazy shindigs that we were knocking about. And it was a time when I first started getting really badly drunk. I used to throw up a hell of a lot, and Matt used to have to look after me, and vice versa. I had to look after him if he had a few dark days. And for a lot of the time, I remember that it was just me and Matt, really. We used to just head out. I can't remember a hell of a lot of it for some reason, but we did used to get blind drunk. And when it wasn't me and Matt, it was Shaun and Matt. It was very rarely the three of us. But when it was, we used to have our dates where we'd go out to pubs such as Dashfields, when it was Dashfields, and there'd be huge parties up there. There'd be loads of people there. And those are days when I could properly remember us all being linked together and hugely drunk. Mostly in due part to alcohol and the diamond. That's one thing I will mention very clearly, the diamond that had a very huge impact on our group and also ACT. The diamond is what I would describe to be a huge place of link up, forgiveness, respect, you know, just coming together. There used to be a lot of us go to that place, and we'd get insanely drunk and do stupid things, but we all had a good time there. So if there's one thing to remember from all this, it's the diamond.
During this time, yeah, we'd all be hanging around, we'd all be drinking. It was around this time that Mike left. Now we're getting to 2011, Mike left. It was 2011. I decided to start filmmaking again, but I didn't want a group this time. I didn't want a group. I didn't want anything from ACT. But I started this group called Dowfilm. Dowfilm International. It was stories I'd written that I had planned to make into films. I remember 2011 being a good year, a very good year, and this brought on a change in my attitude. We were all getting back together. We were all chatting, except for Mike. Mike had left. We understood that. Mike fell in love. And you know, these things happen. We were all getting back together, and we said, oh, you know what? Wouldn't it be great to just do one final project together, you know? Traveling. We had this idea for this film. It was basically just going to be us having a road trip. It was going to be ACT TV on the road with alcohol, not while driving, but you get what I mean. It was like a travel film, and it was going to be called the By Any Means Tour. And the By Any Means Tour was going to have all different places around the country, and we were going to go there. And each episode, it was going to be like a TV show, and each episode was going to be a different place. And we started that. and Adam went to Liverpool. Me, Adam, Shaun, and Daniel Hoggard went to Bovington, down south, and me, Shaun, Adam, and Liam went to London for the weekend, which turned into an absolute piss-up, which we knew it would be.
The By Any Means tour was a great start. I will always say that. We started off really well, and it was a good experience. We planned to do a lot more for it, and to go to a lot more places, but it was always going to be work and money that got in the way of us doing that. But the one thing to remember is that we did start it off a hell of a good way. We went straight to London, and we did a lot of good things in London for our short time there, from what I remember. I think most of it was sort of sightseeing and walking around the streets of Soho, looking around at different kinds of stores and whatnot. There was an alcoholic part of the trip, but it wasn't as huge as I think it should have been. It wasn't that much alcohol involved, it, to be honest with you. But we did get a little bit drunk. We should have gone into the main part of London, but we didn't get time to do that. We knew that getting the tube down there and coming back would be one hell of a problem for us, so we didn't bother at the end of the day. And Liam really wanted to go down there, and Shaun did, and as you can imagine, that caused an insane amount of conflict, but it was in a short period, it was just in one big burst, and then we were fine after. So that started off well, but I believe that we included Liverpool as part of the trip when me and Matt went to Liverpool, and that is an experience that's it's both hard to remember but good to remember when you do remember it. We did get really, really drunk when we went to Liverpool, and there are things that are there that I just can't say.
And then we started doing the By Any Means tours. You know, we went to London. That was a good time. That was more of a bonding session, really, for us all. You know, that was. I do remember that. I remember getting drunk down London. That was quite good. But that's how we all really came back together. And you know, we've been hit and miss, but we're still here and there. We still all speak, you know. And then as we tried to form a little group back together with this By Any Means tour, obviously we tried to rekindle an old flame naturally, but as you say, the spark wasn't there as such. Not everybody was in the same frame of mind. I mean, filming and, oh, I'm not filming now, I can't bother now, I don't want to be on film, I'm not interested in all this. That fell through, and then naturally people do their own things.
And it ended again. And 2011 and everything that we did up until then were plans that never happened. Plans that never reached the light of day. And that was when we called it quits. They called it quits. We called the group quits.
And Matt started doing I think it was Dow Film or something. I think he said he was going to do something else.
Dow Film stayed open. I made sure of that. I made Dow Film work. But Dow Film was like more of a solo project, so I could do with Dow Film whatever the demand was, whatever needed to be done. I could make sure that was done.
My message to everyone from listening to this would be to do what you want and don't let anybody get in your way. If it seems good, go for it. If it feels good, go for it. If it feels bad, don't do it. But one thing to remember is to always keep your spirit up. If you have regrets, regret them. Don't be afraid to regret, despite what everyone in the world says. Everybody has regrets. But if you can accept them and move on from them, then you live more of a life than anyone else.
It's so easy to pick up a video camera and make a film. It's incredibly easy. You can do it on your own, you can do it with other people. It really doesn't matter. I'll be honest, I don't like our stuff. I don't like our stuff at all. Glenn probably did it. And I wouldn't change any of it. I'm glad it's over. I certainly wouldn't change any of it. In fact, we're back. I wouldn't. Everything we did meant something to someone. And that's the best way you can think about anything. Doesn't matter if you like it or not. Someone does. Let it be for them.
Ready, Glenn?
Mr. Cunnington.
His filmmaking group that has helped us with, in hindsight. So please, give him a nice warm welcome.
To Mr. Glenn Howard Cunnington.
The oldest of the two turned to me and handed me a stapled pile of papers, and he introduced himself as a writer. He wanted me to direct this film he'd written.
And then I friended him on Facebook, and I didn't really hear from him for a couple of years, to be honest. And then I think he actually randomly messaged me on, or emailed, I think, me on Facebook or Hotmail, I can't remember that, and said I've got something else. And then we met up at Christmas, we worked on a project and that fell through, and then we just went out for some drinks, and then basically Matt said, I've got this other idea for a project, I think around about June, and I thought it sounds really good, so we took it from there, because I found out this project we could actually literally do within about 2 or 3 days.
I became involved with the project when I wrote it, and then just hoped that everybody would kind of follow me down the rabbit hole, and they did, brilliantly.
Figures. This chap you're going to meet now, from Sutton and Ashfield, Matthew Elliott, has done something which could well change the lives of people worried about or suffering from cyberbullying. And then you had your colleague Glenn, as director. Glenn, hello.
Hello.
So how did you go about telling the story? As a director, you've got to get this as into a thing that people will want to watch.
Well, me and Matt, we've for many years in the past, we did a lot of ACT stuff, and you know, we've done loads of projects, and they're not always great, absolutely not.
And as soon as the interviews were over, they walked away. And I knew it was over.
Thank you. Fuck me! I'm a rapist! What?
Oh, sorry, I've got some one cut.
Scratch off one of you.
In my feet.